saß ich auch mit Simeon, die Freude jenes Lebens schon. Lasst uns mit diesem Manne ziehen. Ach, möchte mich von meines Leibes Ketten der Herr retten. Ach, wäre doch mein Abschied hier nicht Freuden, sagt ich, fällt zu dir, ich habe genug.
Thank you. Good evening. Welcome to 10th. As we conclude our Lord's Day, let's hear God call us to himself from Psalm 148. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his hosts. Pray with me. Gracious God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we do plead in the name of Jesus, that you would send the Holy Spirit to stir our hearts to praise you. That when we contemplate who you are, God, in your glory and in your majesty and in your condescension, that you have come down to save. As we behold this truth tonight, we pray your Spirit would stir our minds and our hearts to glorify your name, to praise you, God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for you are worthy of much praise. Amen.
Thank you. Before we confess our sins together, let's take a moment and bow and confess our sins privately before the Lord. Let's bow together. Using the words you'll find in your bulletin, let's join in confessing our sins together before our Almighty Father. O God, we praise you that your promises never fail, that your faithfulness endures to all generations. Lord, we lament that we are so easily swayed by the temptations of this world, by the desires of our own flesh, by the vain wanderings of our minds. Forgive us when we do not seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, for seeking to build our own dynasties, for the ways our selfish ambitions hurt the lives of others. Father, have mercy upon us. For the sake of our Savior, Jesus, who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for sinners like us. Amen. Hear these words of pardon from Colossians chapter 2. And you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. Be seated. Let's bow together as we go before our Holy Father in prayer. Father, it is a humbling thing to be allowed to speak in your presence, to be able to call you our Father. We marvel at your hand at work all throughout history, showing us your power and your lordship, your never-ending mercy, all pointing us to Jesus. We thank you for giving Jesus to us, your Son, our Savior, to be our perfect sacrifice, the true Israel. Thank you for sending him to lead us out of our darkness and into your light. We're grateful for your word. We know we need your help to receive it this evening. Our minds and our hearts, our souls are prone to wander, so we ask that you would give us focus, attentiveness, that your word would bring conviction, healing, and life. Keep the cares and worries of this coming week away. Let us rest in the knowledge that you will speak to us this evening. We ask that you would be with your servant as he brings your word to us, and may the words of his mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. And now we pray using the words that your Son taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to turn to Matthew chapter 2 in your Bibles. We're going to be reading Matthew 2 verses 13 through 23. If you're using one of the pew Bibles in front of you, that can be found on page 808. So I invite you to turn there and read along with me as I read here. Matthew 2, verse 13 to 23. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Then Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, became furious, and he sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all that region who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had ascertained from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what was spoken by the prophet Jeremiah. "A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping in loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be comforted because they are no more." But when Herod died, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, "Rise, take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are dead." And he rose and took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea in place of his father, Herod, he was afraid to go there, and being warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee. And he went and lived in a city called Nazareth, so that what was spoken by the prophets might be fulfilled, that he would be called a Nazarene.
Thank you.
join in prayer. Father, we thank you for the many gifts you've given to us, most greatly the gift of gifts, your own precious Son. It's a wonder we'll never comprehend that he emptied himself and became like us so that we might have the riches of an eternal inheritance as your children. So we ask that you would now use our tithes so that many more would come to know you and to enjoy that inheritance as well. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, choir, for serving us in that way. Well, perhaps you've been on a bus or a plane where a baby will not stop crying. The baby keeps crying, it keeps crying, and eventually the baby tires out and everybody's relieved, and then the baby starts crying again. It's extremely frustrating. We've all been there. And I can assure you, though, that there are few things more frustrating for a parent than working hard to put a baby to sleep, and then to find that that baby is now awake. Or finding that you have to wake up the baby, even worse. So you can only imagine Mary's frustration when Joseph woke her up in the middle of the night and tells her that they have to leave. As I said, no parent likes waking up their sleeping infant. But on top of that trauma, it's been a long 2 years for Mary. Let me recap some things that she's been through in the last 2 years as we approach our passage. Her venture toward motherhood started with a visitation by an angel. Now, right around that time, the Holy Spirit miraculously conceived the second person of the Trinity in her womb. Then she lived for 3 months with her relative Elizabeth. Eventually, she had to go back and tell her fiancé, Joseph, that she was pregnant and wait to see whether he believed her when she reported the baby was from the Holy Spirit. Then she had to travel almost 90 miles on foot, maybe on a donkey. There's no scripture where it says that they traveled on a donkey. So either on foot or on a donkey from Nazareth to Bethlehem, just to find no room for her to deliver it. After the birth, the shepherds visited her, which is a nice thought, but I can assure you, Mary wasn't exactly excited to have visitors there in the birthing quarters. After the shepherds, then come the wise men, but now there is finally quiet. Finally. It's the middle of the night, and then Joseph wakes up. He wakes her up and tells her they have to wake up the sleeping baby Jesus. The sleeping baby Jesus, gather their belongings, and go to Egypt. Now, we know Mary was a very godly woman. I mean, extremely mature in her trust and faith in Yahweh. Let me just give you a few things. Upon hearing that she was pregnant by the Holy Spirit, without an official husband, you know, she was betrothed, which is kind of like between married and engaged. So she didn't have an official husband, but she kind of had a husband. But she would have been in trouble if she had been pregnant by not the Holy Spirit. So upon hearing that she was pregnant by the Holy Spirit without an official husband, she sang out the Magnificat. The first line, "My soul magnifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God." She was a godly woman. After giving birth, shepherds showed up, as I said, and repeated what the angels had told them. They repeated it to them there in the manger. And they said, "Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Now, when everyone else heard the shepherds say this, they were mostly confused, the scripture tells us. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. Now, as I said, she was a godly woman, but no mom wants to hear she has to wake up her sleeping toddler in the middle of the night. Unfortunately, it was far worse than having to wake up the baby. Now look with me, I hope you have your Bible still open, look with me at Matthew 2:13 to see that this story is just beginning when it comes to intensity. Matthew 2:13, look with me. "Now when they," that is the wise men, "when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, 'Rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him.'" So not only do they wake up the toddler, Jesus, he's probably 1.5 at this point, and they load up their supplies. Jesus is probably crying. And they walk or ride a donkey in the middle of the night toward the Egyptian border, 100 miles or more away. They had to do this, though. Why? They had to do this because Herod is about to destroy baby Jesus. If you're thinking, that's a bit of an exaggeration, Herod was willing to kill his own children, and he did, to make sure they didn't try and come after his crown. So to kill baby Jesus is no thing for Herod. You may be wondering, why did they have to leave so soon? Why the urgency? Why not let baby Jesus get his full night's sleep? Well, Bethlehem was 6 miles from Jerusalem. That means that Herod would have known the next morning that the wise men avoided him and went a different way home. And remember, he wants to know where the king of the Jews was going to be born so he could destroy this political threat. If you were here, you remember we framed that story as the planning behind a political assassination. And Herod had resources. He was the king. And Joseph knew there was no time to lose. Herod and his men or some soldiers could be there to Bethlehem by noon. A fast runner could have traveled the distance in 30 minutes. So upon waking her up, Joseph would have to tell her he had another dream, wherein the angel of the Lord told him, Herod is coming to kill their son. Now this is simultaneously the worst news and the best news imaginable for Mary and Joseph. You might be confused. How could it be the best news? Well, Herod was coming to kill their son. Obviously, that is the worst news. But the Lord had already come to protect their son. Mary's frustration, right? That she's just been woken up. They're going to have to wake up the baby would have immediately transitioned to fear. Oh, no. Herod's coming to kill him. And then from fear to faith. To believe there was a problem is to believe the angel of the Lord is telling them the truth about Herod and directing them to the best way of escape. So I hope you understand. Escaping out of fear and escaping out of faith would look exactly the same for this couple and their baby boy. The tension is obviously profound. Herod was on the attack, but the angel of the Lord was one step ahead. They were living a horror movie, you might say. And yet, they were right in the center of God's will. And not only that, they were in the center of the story of God's epic plan for redemption. And we remember why they named him Jesus. Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. Because he will save his people from their sins. Each page of their family photo album, Jesus' baby book, reveals another picture of the multifaceted gospel of God. But tonight's passage focuses on page 4 of the photo album of Jesus' birth, according to the Gospel of Matthew. So let me recap it for you. On the first 3 pages, you would have found the story of the genealogy, Joseph's decision whether he stays with Mary or not, and then the story of the Magi. Page 1 would have been the genealogy, which focused on Jesus' relationship to King David. Remember, he was born to rule and reign. He was born to rule and reign because he was the son of David. He was also born to bless because he was the son of Abraham, but he was born to rule and reign. The genealogy emphasizes David. And then page 2 of the album would be a picture of when Joseph named him, which would have been symbolic for the fact that Joseph was persuaded by the angel not to divorce Mary and put her away quietly, but instead to take her, to take Mary, to believe her, to trust the angel, to exercise faith that this was Emmanuel. That would have been page 2 of Jesus' photo album. And when he did adopt Jesus, it would have emphasized that Jesus was the son of David, because of course the angel says to Joseph, Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Jesus. Don't be afraid to take Mary, which would imply that he's taking Jesus as his son through adoption. Finally, page 3, our immediate context, the story of the Magi, where the wise men, or the Magi as they're called, come from the east to worship Jesus, who they call the King of the Jews, which of course infuriates Herod. Now, these 3 pages would establish 2 things. First, that Jesus is protected. While in the womb, Jesus is protected by angels, an angel of the Lord who convinces Joseph to adopt him. Then the infant Jesus is being protected when the wise men trick or deceive Herod, as we just read. And then second, in addition to protection, the backstory is established that he is the king. Jesus is the king. He is the son of David, and the nations, that is the people from the east, these wise men, are coming to worship him as who? What do they call him? They call him King of the Jews. So the backstory tells us that Jesus has been protected and that he is king, a strange paradox. Well, the structure of our passage tonight, with this backstory established, hopefully you're caught up. If you haven't been here for one of the Matthew sermons, you at least have the context that's relevant for tonight's passage. But tonight's passage focuses on three primary things. Three primary things. First, the king's escape route, verses 13 through 15. Second, that the king escapes wrath, 16 and 17. And then third, that the escaped king returns, 18 through 23. Three movements, one focused on the route, one focused on the wrath, and one focused on the return. All focused, though, on the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as we'll see, confronting the evil of this world in the face and winning. That's what our passage is focused on. The triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, confronting the most despicable evil imaginable and conquering it. So let's look first at the king's escape route, 2, 13 through 15. The wise men, as I said, have just visited, and on their way home to the east, back home, most likely to Babylon, they're purposely avoiding Herod to make sure he doesn't learn the whereabouts of King Jesus. Now, we'll soon learn that this infuriates Herod. This makes him go into a rage, and he was a wicked, evil man who represents the way the world views the Lord's Christ. He represents the way the world views or looks at the Messiah, the Christ. Psalm 2, if you're familiar, it says, "Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, 'Let us burst their bonds apart and cast away from their cords, cast away their cords from us.'" Now, don't hear me say that everyone is like Herod, willing to shed blood to protect their interests. Now, the grace of God certainly keeps most people from this sort of decision. But the world does stand on Herod's side in its opposition to God and his anointed. Now, if you're doubting that, if you're thinking, no, there's more options than just being on Herod's side or on the side of the Christ, let me ask a few questions. Have you ever heard anyone say, you know, I'd like to be judged by a perfect being who proves I'm guilty of treason? You ever heard anyone just meditate on the fact that they'd like to be judged by a holy God? That they would articulate that they're created, but they don't really want anything to do with their creator, but they would really enjoy to see how they measure up against their creator? No, of course not. Now, most people submit to the theology of the poem Invictus, "I am the master of my fate, I am the captain of my soul." That was Herod's theology. Or in a more calm way, the saying, "Live and let live." Or maybe you like Lennon's song, "Imagine." This is the spirit of the age. This is the spirit of every age. Resistance to the Lord and his anointed. Of course, Herod is demonstrating it at its very worst. But all of us, apart from the saving work of the Holy Spirit, giving us eyes to see Christ, want nothing to do with God, want nothing to do with his judgment. It is true of all humans. This is what happened in Genesis 3, and it's picked up, of course, in Psalm 2, and it is the script Herod is following. He's following the exact script of the Psalms as he conspires against the anointed, which is the Christ. Well, meanwhile, as Herod's scheming and fuming 6 miles away, the royal family, Joseph, Mary, and Jesus are there fast asleep, as I said, in the royal town of Bethlehem when Joseph has a dream, as we've already mentioned. The angel of the Lord appears and says, "Go to Egypt." Now, you should be wondering, who or what is this angel of the Lord? This should be a question we're all pondering. And there are lots of questions we could ask about angels. When did God create them? Something I wonder about. Where are they right now? Are they here? Do we each have our own angel? Recently, someone from our congregation, a three-year-old, asked whether angels go potty. Lots of questions we could ask about angels. Now, we're not going to answer that last one. I'm going to leave that to Liam for another time. But our question is more fundamental? That was a real question I was asked. I liked it. I thought, oh, this three-year-old's meditating on the world according to the scriptures. Our question is more fundamental. Who is the angel of the Lord? And the best summary of the angel of the Lord, I think, comes from the Old Testament scholar, a guy named Tim Mackey. He says, the angel of the Lord is the royal glory of Yahweh appearing as a human. Let me say that again. The angel of the Lord is the royal glory of Yahweh appearing as a human. If Yahweh himself showed up, everyone would be destroyed. No one can stand in the presence of God and live. So God created an angel who can represent him on earth and bring his presence in a terrifying, yes, terrifying, but not deadly way. As Mackey goes on to say, Yahweh is above all inaccessible to us, but sometimes he reveals himself to us in ways that we can see and understand. This is where the character, the angel of the Lord, shows up. He is Yahweh, in a certain sense, made visible to us. Well, so far, the angel of the Lord shows up when Jesus is in trouble. That is, when the infant needs someone to guide his parents. When Jesus' parents need guidance, God gets involved. Why? Both to protect Jesus, as we've already said, and to reveal who Jesus is and what he is doing. Remember what the angel told Joseph, take Mary as your wife. Yes, she is a virgin. Yes, she is pregnant. The baby is Emmanuel. It's from the Holy Spirit, God with us. The angel both protected the baby and revealed his identity. Now then we get to our passage, and the angel is doing the same thing as before, protecting baby Jesus and revealing his identity. Now the protection is obvious. If you look down, go to Egypt. Herod is coming. But the identity is revealed through the route. That's why our heading emphasizes the route that they are instructed to take. Egypt was a Roman colony, just like Judea, and it had an Israelite population, but Matthew tells us the angel of the Lord sends them to Egypt, not because it was a familiar place, not too far away, but to tell us who Jesus is. Now look down with me at verse 15. It says, this was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. The prophet is Hosea, and by saying Jesus fulfills Hosea 11:1, which is what this quotation is from, Matthew is drawing on two important themes in the Old Testament. First, Israel, as you know, as many of you know, went into Egypt and then came out again, right? They pass through the waters of the Red Sea, and then they go into the wilderness, and when they come out, instead of worshiping God, what do? They build the golden calf and worship it. So Jesus is going down into Egypt in order to retrace the steps of the people. And then when he comes out, he is going to pass through the waters. Chapter 3 of Matthew is about the baptism of Jesus. And then look at Matthew chapter 4. Jesus gets tested in the wilderness. He is to go into Egypt to retrace the steps of Israel and fulfill the law every step of the way. Why? To obey where they disobey, to be the righteous substitute for his people, to save his people from their sins, as he is named. So the angel is both protecting the child, as he calls him child, and revealing his identity. He is the true Israel. Not only that, he chooses a very specific quote, which calls Israel God's son. Now, Hosea didn't make this title up. Hosea didn't just decide, oh, let's call Israel the son in this quotation. Listen to Exodus 4, 22 through 23. Then you shall say to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, Israel is my firstborn son. And I say to you, let my son go that he may serve me. If you refuse to let him go, behold, I will kill your firstborn son. So you can see Israel is called God's son, and Jesus, now acting as the representative head, like the head of state, is given the title son. Who is calling him son, though? Look back with me at 2:15. It says, this was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Out of Egypt I called my son. So who is speaking? It's the Lord, yes, by the prophet, but it is what the Lord had spoken. What does that mean? It means that the Lord is Jesus's Father. The Lord is Jesus' father. Do you see the angel is not only protecting the child, the King of the Jews, as he was called. Jesus, the one who will save us from our sins. Emmanuel, the one who is God with us. The son of Abraham, the one who brings blessing. The son of David, the one who is the good king. He is calling him the son of Yahweh. You see why the angel of the Lord keeps showing up. God the Father is sending him to protect his son. The angel of the Lord is the royal glory of Yahweh appearing as a human. Why? To protect God the Son. The Son has to enter. This is important. The Son has to enter into the fallen world with all of its dangers. And that world wants to kill him immediately. But Jesus hasn't fulfilled the law yet there at age one or two. He hasn't fully defeated Satan as he's about to do in chapter four and then at the cross. He hasn't walked Israel's path and become the perfect sacrifice for sin through his resistance to temptation after temptation after temptation. To become a sympathetic high priest, he must be tempted as we are in every respect, yet without sin. And not just tempted, he must enter into this world of death and defeat it willingly, not as an infant who gets assassinated. Why? This is what the whole sermon's about. So he can show us the amazing love of the triune God. Jesus doesn't just come to die. He comes to show us he is willing to die. If he just needed to die, then Herod could have assassinated him and he would have been the sacrifice for sin. But he is a willing savior. So the Father is saving his son from the wrath of Herod. Why? So his son can go down to Egypt. Why? And walk Israel's path perfectly, perfectly obeying his heavenly Father when he is tempted, not worshiping any other gods. Why? So he can become the worthy sacrifice that we need, the perfect lamb who has perfectly obeyed the law, the obedient one who conquers sin and death and the devil by willingly dying, laying down his life of his own accord. The Father saves his son from Herod's wrath so that his son can willingly save you from God's righteous wrath. The Father has willingly saved his son here by sending the angel to send him to Egypt. He has saved his son from Herod's wicked wrath, so his son can save you and I, wicked sinners, from God's righteous wrath. So that the son can willingly lay down his life. So that he can willingly save his people, those who repent from their sins. I hope if you're wondering about the heart of God, that it's on full display for you here tonight. That God, the Father, would protect the Son both because he loves him and he has loved him perfectly from eternity past. And that love gets expressed here in the protection that he has for infant Jesus, waking him up in the middle of the night, waking up his parents, sending them to Egypt, protecting this beloved son, as he calls him, one chapter later in Matthew 3 at the baptism. My beloved son is what he calls him, one chapter later. The love that God the Father and God the Son have together is the source and fount of all love, but it overflows. It overflows towards sinners. So that the Father doesn't just love his son, he protects him so that the son can then save sinners. In this little section, this little obscure section of Matthew, the heart of God is on full display. And hopefully it slows us down and gives us pause and makes us wonder whether it's really true. That God the Father protected, even saved, you might say, God the Son, so that the Son could willingly save sinners. Well, the King, Jesus, escapes this wrath, as I've said. He escapes this wrath so that he can save us from wrath. And the escape is highlighted in chapter 2, 16 and 17. It says, then Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, became furious And he sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all of that region who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had ascertained from the wise men. Now hopefully you understand what's going on in the narrative. Herod, full of wrath and rage, right? Psalm 2 tells us that his rage is profound. He rages against the Lord and against his anointed. And in his rage, he decides, I have to make sure I kill this king of the Jews. Whoever it is that these wise men were talking about, I'm going to make sure that he's dead. How am I going to do it? Well, we're going to just make sure all the babies are dead in Bethlehem. So he assassinates, murders probably 20 babies based on how many people were living in Bethlehem at that time. 20 babies aged under two. Why? Just to cover his bases, to make sure. Because he rages against the Lord and against his anointed. But what does Matthew want us to think about this? Look at 17. It says, then was fulfilled what was spoken by the prophet Jeremiah. This is Jeremiah 31, extremely important passage. A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping and a loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be comforted because they were no more. Now, Rachel is considered the matriarch of the people of Israel. And the people of Israel, she'd been dead for centuries, but her tomb was there. And the people of Israel are, in a sense, marching past her tomb into exile to Babylon. And Rachel is figuratively weeping. But Jeremiah tells us that this weeping will not be forever. The immediate next passage in Jeremiah, this is Jeremiah 31, 15. The immediate next passage, verse 16, tells her to have hope. Why? Why? Because this weeping would not last forever. The weeping would end. How would it end? The end of Jeremiah 31, the new covenant would come. The new covenant would come. Matthew is pointing us through this horror of these babies being killed to the reality that Jesus was saved by his Father so that he could go into exile and then come back and be the new covenant, fulfill the covenant on our behalf, and then shed his blood for the remission of sins. What does he say at the Passover? This is my blood. This is my body broken for you. The new covenant. He saves him so that he can fulfill the covenant, so that there would be no more weeping, so that there would be no more murders, so that people would not rage against the Lord and his anointed, so that Rachel and all who mourned at this reality would be able to stop their weeping. Matthew is saying from the beginning, where when the exile occurred in Jeremiah 31, all the way until now, is a season of weeping. But Jesus has been spared. He's been saved. Why? So that he can go into Egypt, retrace the steps, live the perfect life, and then fulfill the new covenant. How? By shedding his own blood. He was saved so that he could save you. He was saved so he could save me. He was saved so that he could save his people from their sins. He was spared from the wrath of Herod so that he could go and then bring the new covenant in his blood. God the Father saved God the Son from wrath, the wrath of Herod, the wrath of this world. Why? So that God the Son could willingly save sinners, repentant sinners, from the righteous wrath of God. We'll look at the final points as we conclude. The escaped king returns, 19 through 23. We've already heard it read, so I'll just summarize the main points. The angel of the Lord shows up again, and what does he say? He says, take the child and his mother and go back home. The enemies who wanted to take the child's life are dead. He's talking about Herod. And so what does he do? He rises and he takes the child and he comes home, but he finds out there is another threat on the scene. There's this other ruler who's potentially threatening to Jesus. So what does he do? He has to pivot from going back to Bethlehem and he goes all the way to Nazareth. Now, last point. Matthew points us to now the prophets, plural. Look at verse 23. Let me interpret what's happening here through Matthew's lens. He says he went and lived in a city called Nazareth, that what was spoken by the prophets might be fulfilled. He shall be called a Nazarene. Now, there is no quotation in the Old Testament that says he shall be called a Nazarene. This shouldn't surprise us. Matthew says the prophets, plural. He says the prophets, what was spoken by the prophets might be fulfilled. All the other times he just says prophet, singular. But here he says prophets. Why? Because he's talking about a theme. A theme that was true of the Old Testament was that the Messiah would be despised, rejected, abhorred. Isaiah 49, Daniel 9, you can look these up. The prophets were declaring that when the Messiah came, he would not be loved and favored. Well, Nazareth was like the worst place in Israel. I won't name a city that and say like, oh, it's kind of like this, because somebody's got to be from that city. So imagine the worst city you can imagine. I'm from Texas. You can imagine Texas. Texas isn't the worst, but allows you to carry the thought forward. Imagine the worst place that you can think of. That's Nazareth. They had to go to Nazareth. Why? To fulfill the reality that the Messiah, the anointed one, the king, would be despised. Nathanael in John 1 says, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Whenever he first hears about Jesus starting his ministry, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Enemies of the church in Acts call him a Nazarene sect. It's a way of insulting them. Jesus goes into exile, down to Egypt, returns. But upon his return, his ministry begins the worst place in Israel, so that his identity as king and yet suffering king, shameful king, despised king, worthless king in the eyes of the world would be clear for everyone to see. Because the way God redeems us, the way he saves us from our sins, is not by coming and conquering the way the Jews expected, setting up some sort of military regime to kick out Rome, to get rid of Herod. No, he came lowly, humble, despised. Why? Because we need a substitute for our shame. We need one who is lowly and despised like us, but not because of his merit, but because of his choice, that he would choose to willingly be a Nazarene, that he would choose to willingly shed his blood to fulfill the new covenant, that he would willingly go down to Egypt to retrace the steps and bring God's people out of exile. God the Father saved God the Son from this wrath, brought him back to Israel. Why? So that God the Son could willingly start his ministry, which he does in chapter 3, start his ministry and display to everyone the heart of the gospel, that God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, together, working as one, unfolded the plan of redemption for sinners like you and me, people who are not like Jesus, people who are more like Herod when we look in our hearts, for people like us to see that God wants to save sinners, that Jesus willingly went to the cross. He says, no one takes my life from me. I lay it down of my own accord. And now this king, Jesus, the one who willingly lived in shameful Nazareth, willingly took on our sin, willingly shed his blood to inaugurate the new covenant, he has not stayed forever lowly, forever shameful, forever dead. No, he is now the conquering king, the one who has conquered death, the one who has conquered our sin, the one who has conquered the devil and his minions, the one who now reigns and protects us and rules us and blesses us by his Spirit. If you're wondering if God is mean or cold, I hope this passage tonight shows you God the Father protecting God the Son, saving, you might say, God the Son from wrath, so that God the Son could willingly save sinners like you and me from wrath. As we conclude this Christmas season, I pray this is how you would be thinking about God. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, active, drawing sinners back to the presence of God. Let's pray. Gracious Father, we do rejoice that you protected King Jesus, enabling him to save us from our sins. Send your Spirit now, we pray, to stir in our hearts a clear sight of who you are, the loving God, holy and pure, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now receive the Lord's benediction. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.